This podcast is part of the Batman Universe Podcast Network, hosted by the batmanuniverse.net. Check out everything related to Batman and the entire Bat family at the batmanuniverse.net, including news and original content related to comics, movies, television, merchandise, video games, and more. Also, check out some of the other unique podcasts that TBU has to offer. Consider supporting this podcast by becoming a patron on Patreon. Even $1 can go a long way in supporting this content that you enjoy. Look for a link over at thebatmanuniverse.net to offer your support now. And now, on with the show.
I think I can sum up the show for you with one word. Nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing.
What does that mean?
The show is about nothing.
Well, it's not about nothing.
No, it's about nothing.
Well, maybe in philosophy, but even nothing is something.
Hey, James.
Hey, how's it going?
Not too bad. Oh, thanks for doing that with I get my tongue tied. Thanks for doing the show with us. See, I'm already off to a bad start already.
No, thanks for having me. I was just earlier today listening to the Lonely Place of Living radio drama, which was awesome. I was really thrilled. It was one of those things. I definitely was like, oh, I'll just listen to like 5 minutes of this, and then like an hour later, like, cleaning up around my apartment, being like, yeah, that moment was awesome.
Well, thanks.
I think you just made Rob's century right there.
Yeah. Well, that's the end of the interview, folks. I'm done. We're gonna sign off. This is the shortest episode of the show. We had little jokes back and forth while we were putting it together. Terrence would say, you know, you're probably going to get a letter from James like, dear Mr. Myers, contact the lawyers at DC, and he's going to be like, hey, before you sue me, can you sign these things really quick?
No, I would, like, seriously, it's an incredible honor that you guys would put, like, that you would put so much, like, heart and soul into that, and even just, like, being able, like, weaving in a bit more of the Wolfman stuff and, like, all of that, like, it really, really worked. And it was, like, it was also interesting to see the areas, like, I understand, like, for intercutting doesn't work as well in audio, so it's, like, seeing how, like, where you made those decisions, and, like, that was interesting in and of itself. I don't know. It's, like, it's interesting because it's so rare to see your own work kind of, like, broken down and, like, kind of reworked for another medium. And it's always interesting to see, like, what people take from it and, you know, what people lean into. So, I don't know. It was, it was a good experience.
Cool. I think that was the hardest thing I had to when I was putting it together, going, I tried to do it beat for beat by the comic. I think I have three versions of it, and one I was trying to get, like, okay, how can I make this sound flashbacky? So I was doing weird effects. I thought, you know what, I'm just going to try play it linear. So it's kind of cool to hear from the writer of the issue that, hey, it worked out. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Look, if you want to just keep doing the same old thing, then maybe this idea is not for you. I, for one, am not going to compromise my artistic integrity. And I'll tell you something else. This is the show, and we're not going to change it. Right?
How about this? You don't like the Drake.
I hate the Drake.
I love the Drake.
How could you not like the Drake?
Who's the Drake?
Who's the Drake?
The Drake is good. Do you like the Drake?
I love the Drake.
What about the Drake? Oh, screw the Drake. I love the Drake.
This podcast will take a chronological look at the third boy to wear the mantle of Robin, Tim Drake, through the 90s and 2000 Robin series, Red Robin, Young Justice, and Teen Titans. And from time to time, taking a look at the modern era of Tim Drake in the pages of DC Comics, while also talking about other Robin and Batman happenings in the world. So sit back and relax and find out why everyone loves the Drake.
good for them. Love the Drake.
Got to love the Drake.
I'm impressed.
What can I say? I'm irresistible.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Robin, Everyone Loves the Drake Comic Podcast, brought to you by the BatmanUniverse.net. You can find us through two universe podcasting networks if you want to, through the Batman Universe Podcasting Network over at TBU, and on Batman on Film through their BatmanPodcastNetwork.com. You can get a hold of us through all the social media. You know where we're at Facebook, Twitter, ELTD Podcast. See, it's been too long since we've done a show. ELTD Podcast. And we're on Instagram, and I always say email, but I don't think people do that anymore. But Robin, ELTD Podcast at Yahoo.com. And Terrence has been doing some stuff for Young Justice over on YouTube. And I think he's getting ready now that school is done for him. He's starting to do some stuff over there. This is episode 76. And this is what we're going to call our inventory episode, because we need a show for this month. And there's been, this is kind of like our summer break. So we've got Ryan with us today, and Ryan's been on a summer break adventure. He's done like a couple adventures. I can't wait to hear that. How are you doing today, Ryan?
I'm doing good. I say, when you were talking about the idea for this episode, I was like, you know what? That's actually kind of great, because it's kind of a nice, you know, summertime and living's easy. Kind of, you know, I got that song in my head, you know,
the cotton is high. Oh, your daddy's rich.
It's kind of good to take a break, take inventory. We've had our, we're talking Robin, then we had our gigantic, you know, audio drama, and then the really spectacular interview with Tynion, and now it's like, yeah, but we don't have Terrence with us today. Unfortunately, we missed Terrence today, yes. And so it's like, well, what can we do? Let's just talk about all the comic book stuff we got going on in our world for this summer, and it's kind of a nice. It should be a nice little midsummer break here, talking comics, talking Robin.
Oh yeah, definitely. And with as invasive, I guess probably more for me than anybody, just as the drama was. But even just going back from the drama, we had Bill Augustine, if I'm saying his last name right, that I did with you guys over on BOF, and then
man, you butchered that. Brian Augustine,
my God, see, it's been too long. Brian, I'm so sorry. I knew what came out of my mouth if that was wrong. But then a few months later, we had Chuck Dixon for Nightfall, and then we did the huge 3-hour extravaganza for Tynion's whole Detective Comics run, and then the radio drama was mixed in there. It was a packed, you know, couple months of just
hopefully all the listeners have appreciated this. Because for us, it's been like just a nerd dream come true, doing all this crazy, like interviewing people we, you know, creators we respect, and then doing crazy stuff like this audio drama. It's just been really great, really, really good stuff.
Well, I want to ask how your summer's been going. I've kind of known of some things that you've been doing. In my notes, I've got Ryan's adventures from Ernest to a comic book warehouse that I can't wait to hear that trip that you just took today. So I'm just going to turn the floor over to you. Ryan, what have you been doing this summer?
So it was funny to listen to the last episode with the with a Tynion interview, because when you were talking about why I was gone and, you know, we're just trying to figure it out, like, he said he was going to an Ernest convention, so the Ernest Day, Ernest P. Worrell, and he wasn't lying about it. It was a real thing, and we weren't sure. He's going to have to explain himself when he comes back on the show. So, but yes, Ernest Day, it was a real thing. It, if anybody's, you know, uninitiated, I mean, if you're a child of the 80s or early 90s, you should know Jim Varney, Ernest P. Worrell, and you know, that was definitely a part of my childhood, you know.
Safety first, that's my motto. When one is doing dangerous work, one must pay careful attention to the safety of one's body. Know what I mean? But one day, I'll be a camp counselor, and I'll be running this place. I'll be shaping and molding youthful minds into a focused worldview. Yep. Ernest P. Worrell, camp counselor. An extraordinary thing to witness.
I always loved those movies, and then as I grew up, I just kind of started to appreciate, you know, the Jim Varney, the actor, more, just to figure out like what went into that performance and what went into his career and stuff like that. And over the past couple of years, there's been a lot of, you know, as we, you know, kids from all us as kids are growing up, all this nerdy stuff is coming back in the form of podcasts, like we're doing, you know, Tim Drake Robin podcast. Yeah. And so now Ernest is becoming, you know, people are reexamining it again, you know, beyond That's a cool. level, beyond a level where it was being examined at the time. So there is a really good podcast called Ernest Goes to Podcast, and it's not even a review show per se, but it's more like a character analysis podcast of the character, and they go through pretty much every single piece of merch media that Ernest was in. The show's on hiatus at the moment because they've covered pretty much everything. I think they only have a few episodes left to go, but it's a really good podcast. They go super deep, super down the rabbit hole. Of just the movies and Ernest and Jim Varney and stuff like that. And they even went to visit Jim Varney's nephew, Justin Lloyd, who wrote a biography a couple years ago about Jim Varney and his life and Ernest and all that. And it's really good. That's actually how I found the podcast, was through that book. I got the book, and the book talked about the podcast, and I listened to the podcast, and then, you know, the rest is history. And then, so there was a lot of just fun little, you know, trying to rekindle my love for the character going on over the past couple of years. And then one of the recent episodes of that podcast, they talked about this event that happened in 2017 called Ernest Day. And, of course, I was super bummed when I found out about it because it had already taken place. I missed it. So 2017 was the 30th anniversary of Ernest Goes to Camp, which is the first mainline Ernest movie. You know, if you want to get real nerdy, there's Dr. Otto and the Riddle of the Gloom Beam.
Right.
But that's a whole other conversation. But the first Disney mainline Ernest movie was Ernest Goes to Camp. 30 year anniversary was in 2017. And so they had this event at the Montgomery Bell State Park in Burns, Tennessee. It's in West Tennessee. It's like west of Nashville. And that's where at that state park is where the Ernest Goes to Camp was filmed. And they, to celebrate the 30th anniversary, they held this event called Ernest Day, and they had it at the actual filming location, and they had actors from the film, they had the director and creator of Ernest there, they had, so they had all this stuff, and then, but I just found out about it, and I was like, oh man, I missed it, and so, and that was last year, 2017, and then I was trying to think, I wonder if they'll do that again for a second year, because it was so successful. And so I checked back now and then, and I wasn't sure if they were going to have it or not. And then all of a sudden, I found out that they were going to do it this year, and it was only like 3 weeks out. So had a mad dash of trying to plan it. You know, we've got our daughter; she just turned one, so we had to figure out how we're going to make this work.
Grandma, Grandpa.
Well, yeah, no, we took her with us. We did it. We took her with us. So, so we planned this trip and drove. Oh man, it was like 8-9 hours or so, and we planned like a big long weekend. So we went out this year because I was worried if we didn't go this year, maybe they wouldn't do it again,
right?
Or do it a few more years down the line or something. So I really wanted to go out this year. So we went, and it was really spectacular. There's nothing else like it, you know, an Ernest convention almost. It's like one of the only ways you could do something like this. And so if you go to my Twitter, you can dig in some of the pictures and stuff, because I had a big thread about it. And they really went all out, because if you've seen the movie Ernest Goes to Camp, you know, they really did the camp up to look like the film. As soon as you pulled in, they had a Camp Kickakee like sign, like the big wooden sign. They had a awesome. The camp, they had the Camp Kickakee golf cart. They a lot of the places around the camp. See, the camp was built in the 30s by the CCC, the Civilian Conservation Corps.
Okay.
And so it's old, it's got no air conditioning and everything. It's like the perfect like camp like site for this kind of a movie. And so they had all this stuff from the movie, and then they had they gave you a map when you got in. And all of the places in the camp that were filming locations, they had these little plaques up. So like you would go to the first aid booth and they would have a picture of the film there. So you knew, oh, that's the first aid booth in the movie. Or this is where, the Last Chance boys were playing poker with Ernest, or this is where Ernest's, counselor's cabin was, where he's saying, you know, gee, I'm glad it's raining. So they did that. And, they had the big counselor's cabin had, film props from the movie in there. They had like the tray that gets like smashed on Ernest's face. They had that. The mess hall had like the flagpole outside had a screen used Camp Kickakee flag. They had that flying up in the air. They had Camp Kickakee t-shirt, Ernest Day t-shirts for you to buy. Justin Lloyd, who I mentioned earlier, Jim Farney's nephew, he was there signing books. So I got to meet him. I got to, I had read the book digitally, but I was able to buy a book there and talk to him for a minute, get him to sign a book, which was great. They had all kinds of camp activities. They had canoeing and fishing and not fishing. They had canoeing and archery and a nature hike and a birds of prey program. They just had all kinds of stuff just to kind of, make it a nice family friendly just day. And they did have two actors from the movie, and they had the returning director and creator of Ernest, John Cherry, was there. So I got them to sign some of my Ernest merchandise, and they also had like a free print with all their faces on it, you know, that you could sign, an Ernest Day print you could sign. And it's worth mentioning, like, the whole event was free, which is just ridiculous.
Oh,
they
wow,
had all
really?
These volunteers to, yeah, so and then at the end of the day they had like an Ernest lookalike contest and a trivia contest, and then they had a Q&A panel with the special guests, you know, the actors and the director. And then the last thing they did was they showed the movie on a big inflatable screen outdoors, you know, as the night, you know, as it got dark outside in the afternoon. So it was like a full day event of just Jim Varney appreciation, basically. And it's so unique, and it was so much fun. So I would definitely recommend it. Hopefully they'll do it next year, because it seemed like it was a big success. And so now there's another new Ernest podcast that just started. I think it's called the Importance of Seeing Ernest. And so hopefully if that's still going next year, maybe they'll have like a live podcast there or something like that. I'm hoping. So yeah, that was such a good time. So there's the scoop on Ernest Day.
Wow. And I, while you were talking, I just looked up. I had forgotten that he passed away in February 10th.
2000,
my birthday.
Oh.
Yeah. But I didn't realize it had been that long since he'd been gone. And
yeah, he was a young man. He was only 50.
Wow.
Died of lung cancer, yeah.
And so your other adventure, which I was already excited for you for the Ernest Day, and the comic warehouse thing that you did today. All I'm just picturing is you and Indiana Jones walking into this warehouse with a sea of comic books. And from a couple of the pictures that you sent, I think it was almost kind of that. So you could just talk a little bit on that and what you scored.
So if you go to go to either my Twitter or go to the Batman on Film Instagram, you'll see some pictures. But yeah, so like one of our local comic stores, one of the ones that me and Terrence both go to, Ultimate Comics, they have here in North Carolina, they have like three locations. They have like a Raleigh, a Durham, and a Cary location. And a few weeks ago, they actually had what they called a crime spree. Like all three of their locations got simultaneously broken into like overnight, and thousands of dollars of merchandise got stolen.
What, seriously?
Yeah.
Oh wow, I thought this was like a an advertisement for this thing. Oh, wow, okay.
No. Like,
that completely sucks then.
Yeah, like they had like their glass smashed in and stuff like that. They had stuff stolen.
Wow.
So that was kind of a big, like, big thing. And so they are one of the stores that has an exclusive Batman number 50 variant that just came out. And if you know anything about how comic book stores work and how these variants work, they'll make you like I don't know, DC or whoever makes you order like, I don't know, thousands or whatever copies of the actual normal Batman 50, so you can like unlock the privilege of getting your own store exclusive variant.
Jeez.
You can't just be like, oh, I want a store exclusive variant. You have to like pony up the money for it. Just like, you know, whenever there's like variant issues, you have to be like, whenever it's like, it's a 1 in 50 variant, that means that the store had to get 50 copies, regular copies, to get one variant. Gosh. So it's kind of like that. To get a store exclusive variant, you have to order a whole bunch of regular copies just to get the opportunity of having your own store exclusive variant. So they were like, they're on their Twitter and social media being like, yeah, this really sucked. If you want to help out, buy a copy of our exclusive variant, because we need to get those sold and stuff. So and that's actually how I found out about the variant. So I was like, yeah, I was going to get that comic anyway. And so might as well get the store exclusive variant. That's kind of a cool thing to do.
Yeah.
So then, and I don't know if this is related or whatever, but so just yesterday, I was just looking at their social media, and they were saying like, "Oh, tomorrow we're gonna have an exclusive, an exclusive secret comic book warehouse sale." And I was like, "What? What is this?" And so apparently, I guess they only do this like once a year, but they have a super secret warehouse where they house all of their like back issues and like stuff they haven't like sorted yet, or just all the overstock and everything they have for all their stores. And I didn't know they did this. And it was really interesting because, it was today from like 10 to 4, and they had all these deals and stuff. They had like, I'll just kind of get into it. So when they say it's super secret, It kind of is, because once they gave you the address, if you look at the Instagram, once you pull up to this thing, the door actually says, with an official logo, like, Ultimate Comics Super Secret Warehouse. And normally, and it's awesome, it's kind of this crazy thing, and it's normally by appointment only, but I guess for this special sale, they've got it open for the public. So so what they did, and what's funny is, like, they had like a picture of the warehouse from Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
On there, and I'm like, how big could this warehouse be? It's probably just like an office building with just a bunch of comic book boxes or whatever. And no, they're absolutely correct. You go into this place, and it's a little deceptive at first, because you go in, and so what the deal was, you go in, they have like a little open room, and they had a whole bunch of like, I don't know, 30, 40 boxes, long boxes out, and that room, the first room you go in, was like, that was your dollar comics. And they had this deal going on. You could get $100 comics for $40, which is a pretty good deal. And, yeah. But, you know, of course, it's the whole, like, they're semi-organized, but not really. There's just everything, anything and everything is just in these long boxes. you know, going from present day, like, you'd have a box of, like, Rebirth Suicide Squad or Action Comics, and then the next box would have like, you know, X-Force from like the 90s or something, and it would just be all kinds of, and they're all mixed up. So but you know, nevertheless, there were a lot of people searching in that. So I did that for a while, but then after you get past that room, you go past this room, and they have like the giant Indiana Jones like warehouse, floor to ceiling comic book boxes. It literally is like one of the coolest, you know, nerd comic book moments ever, because I've been to some comic book conventions and stuff, but I've never been been filled with such wonder of like, oh man, what could be in here and stuff like that. And so all the stuff in this giant warehouse part was up for grabs too. And like, their rules were like, they had one wall that was nothing but things that they had already sorted through that were their eBay listings. So if you wanted any of that stuff, you had to like note that and take it to them so they could like delist it from eBay and stuff. But all that stuff was cover price. But then other than that, everything else was just this giant, like unorganized giant warehouse of comics. And it was, not going to lie, it was a little overwhelming. So what I ended up doing was I spent a couple hours in there and just kind of picked through the boxes as best as I could. And once my stack got gigantic enough, I just had to kind of be like, well, I could spend another, you know, lifetime in here, but I better just see how much all this stuff is. And so before I, you know, blow it and go overboard, because I know we all talked about our Ollie's experiences. Well, I don't think I was on that episode, but yeah, we all went to Ollie's and we spent a pretty penny there, but I got a lot more nice traditional comic book finds at this sale. So I spent like $100. Don't tell my wife. She's in the next room. I spent $100. But I didn't get the I didn't quite hit the 100 books thing, so I got like so I spent like $60. No, I spent like $40 on the dollar books. And then the other 60 was a bunch of the stuff that I got from the big back room. And the dollar books, I got a whole bunch of like Superman, New 52 Superman issues. I was trying to find like the Jeff Johns, John Romita Jr. run. I heard that was pretty good. So I was trying to fill in the gaps in my collection there. They had a giant box of the Dark Knight. What is that title? What is that title, Rob? That's easy. Legends of the Dark Knight. They had a big Legends of the Dark Knight box, so I grabbed a whole bunch of those issues. And but in the big back room, they had some really kind of cool gems that jumped out. I ended up getting a first printing trade paperback of A Death in the Family, the one from '88, and it's really cool because it's like, you can tell it's old. It's got the black cover, Death in the Family, and everything like that. So yeah, so I ended up getting all these issues and stuff, but trying to fill gaps in my collection. I've been trying to complete my like New 52 Detective run because at one point during the New 52, I kind of stopped getting all the books except for Batman, I was like, yeah, and then I was like, well, I don't really care about Detective anymore as a collector because the numbering is all busted and it doesn't matter anymore and stuff like that. And so of course, as you know, after the Rebirth started, they factored in all the New 52 numbers into the timeline of numbers. So if you want to fill in the gaps, you know, the renumbered Volume 2 New 52 numbers are actually doing double duty as actual like 9, 30, 40, 50, whatever numbers. So if you want a complete collection, you need to go back and get all the New 52 issues. And so now I had to make last night I was making a list of like, you know, it's only a handful of issues, but it was when I was so done with it. So now I'm like, dang it, I need to actually get the issues to complete the collection. So I was able to pick up a couple of those as well for cheap.
I was just, while you were talking there, I was scrolling through my comic app, and I stayed on for like the beginning of the New 52, and I made it to the end of issue 5, and then I dropped it, and then I got back on at issue 9, the Death of the Family, but by issue 18, I went straight through, and I actually stopped at 47, so I ended up getting back on when the creative teams changed back over, and I really liked it once you get to Francis Manipole being on the book. Then I was like,
yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I stopped around the Emperor Penguin arc and definitely stopped on the Wrath arc.
That's where I picked it back up because of Fabok.
Right.
Yeah.
And then I also came back when Manipole and Buccellato was on, because I was like, oh, that's such a good creative team. Yeah, but then, unfortunately, I never did read that story because I think my comic store like didn't get one of the issues, and so like I never never finished it. But I've got the issues now, and I even have the trade. You know, I got the trade when we did the big Ollie's thing. Yeah. So
that's a good.
Did
run.
You ever read that story? Yeah. Is it a good story?
That's a really solid good story, and I was disappointed. I think that's why I end up leaving off at the end of their run. It was really really good.
Yeah, and because then after you get that, then you go to Blue Bunny Suit Batman stuff. Even though it's Tomasi and it's good, but right. It's of course it's not the Batman most people want to be reading, I guess.
Yeah.
And then of course I've got to get the annuals and stuff like that now too. So it's just kind of a big darn it, should have known better.
Right.
Should always just collect Batman and Detective no matter what and all
right.
that kind of thing. So but I did end up getting some surprisingly, which surprised me. I got a really good deal on some vintage, some old comics, like Silver Age-y type stuff. I got I got Detective 379,
nice,
and 380, and 516, and then I got Batman 173.
Holy crap! Into the 100s.
Yes, and 191, which is a really cool issue. It's like the day Batman sold out, it's like Batman's having a bat auction, everything must go. And he's like selling everything. He's like selling like the bat phone and like Robin's costume and batarangs and bat ropes and stuff, and everybody's crying, like Dick Grayson and Alfred's crying, like, I can't believe it's a classic Infantino art.
Right.
That whole era. And I found, I don't know, this is like a speculative pick, but I got The Hawk and Dove number 2, which of course is Steve Ditko, the great Steve Ditko, just passed away
right.
a couple of days ago, and he created Hawk and Dove, and so I saw this, I was like, oh man, this is kind of a cool looking thing, and it's the number 2 issue, it's got it's Hawk and Dove, and it's like October 1968 cover, so yeah, and it's all Steve Ditko art. So I thought I'd spring for that too. So
yeah, it sounds like you're trying to play this Golden Age, Silver Age game that Peter and I are playing. He buys an old book, I buy an old book.
Yeah,
there were a couple books where it was like we bought the same book.
Yeah, so like yeah, if Pete's listening to this, hopefully like somebody else will try to pick up some of this stuff. Because it's fun. Because for me, I it's hard to go back and know, and I'm not trying to, make money or whatever, but I do like, old key issues if you can find them for a good price, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Especially for me, if it's Batman or Detective, I'm always interested because I'm always trying to, get as a complete as of a run as I can for those respective series. And so... So I just love to get these old Detective issues, and to that end, a couple of days ago you were texting me and Terrence's picture of this comic you got, and I was like, that's not that great a condition. And then I started looking up how much it is, and I was like, that's actually a really good price for what it is. So I started looking on eBay too. I'm like, no, I want that issue. So it's the whole everybody's trying to get the same vintage issues.
Right, exactly. So what Ryan is talking about, I was at this little hole in the wall shop, which I don't even hardly ever go there. It's really kind of out of the way. I think I had to drive almost an hour to get there, and there's no reason for me to go the direction I'm going other than, oh, I haven't been to this shop in a while, and it's really kind of dank. It's the prototypical or the atypical, what people, or more cliche is probably the better word, of what people think the comic shops are. Just this dirty hole in the wall, old toys that nobody's buying. But there, I'm thinking like you, okay, I want some back issues, and it's a good spot because nobody's really shopping at this place, and I keep thinking one of these days it's going to close. So I went there. I was picking up some, '90s, Batman Detective, just from spots that I needed. And I saw his wall of books, and I saw this book on the wall, and I'm like, okay, it's probably going to be completely out of the price range. And like Ryan said, it does look kind of beaten up, and it is Batman 244. So if anybody knows what 244 is, the title of it says The Demon Lives Again. It's a shirtless Batman with what almost appears to be the sword in his chest, but it's beside him with Ra's al Ghul shirtless holding the bat costume. And I'm like, oh, holy crap. That's a Neil Adams cover. Like, This is the closest I've been to it. And I'm like, it's probably going to be $60 or $80. It could have been $4,000, you know, for that matter. And I was like, well, yeah. And it was just far enough back on his wall that I couldn't see what it was. And I almost didn't ask him what the price was because I thought, I don't want to hear what this price is. And he said, oh, I got that for $15. And I said, I'll take it. And it's beat up. If I do it, I'll put up on the Facebook and the Twitter so you can see it. And when I open it up, it's got a small little hole in the back of it. But I'm like, I don't care. This is as close to this book as I'm going to get. And just a beat up copy like I'm getting. Seeing it on eBay and things like that are going for, you know, $30, $40
Exactly. Yeah. Once I started looking it up and researching, I'm like, actually, that's a really good price for what it is.
So then some of the comic book groups that I'm on in Facebook, they're like, no, that's pretty good. There's character, there's love to that book. And people were showing me their beat up copies. And I'm like, oh, that doesn't make me feel so bad. And then, of course, there's that one person that's like, I got a 9.8 CGC graded. You know, it's worth $2,000. I'm like, well, of course you do, you jerk.
Yeah.
But that's just cool to find a little nugget like that. Or even just, as much as I like reading all the new stuff and Rebirth, there's something cool about just going to a warehouse or a comic book store and just finding some old issues of something that you may have kind of didn't pay attention to at one time, and then you're like, oh, this is really cool, or there's a hole I want to fill. You start reading it, you go, well, crap, why wasn't I reading this, you know? So that's
my thing too. Like ever since we've started doing this show and everything, I've started to make little, you know, Excel sheet lists of runs I'm trying to get, like all the Azrael issues, which I do now have, and all the Tim Drake Robin issues. So when I go to a place like this, I know what holes I'm trying to fill.
Right.
And, you know, just to keep it on, to keep it topical, I saw two Robin issues of the Tim Drake series. I saw Robin number one, you know, the collector's edition. And I forget what number it is, but it's the one, it's the big black cover where, and it's like Robin Unmasked. I found that one.
Yeah.
Yeah. And unfortunately I have both of those in my collection. I was just anxious. I was hoping that I would find some nice random box full of nothing but Robin, but that didn't happen.
That was something I was actually doing today. I think I probably said on the show before the way that I alphabetize all my comics, but if Robin and Catwoman and Nightwing are inside the main Batman story, then I file those books in order that the story goes, and I don't necessarily have, like, Robin 16 isn't with Robin 16, it's with the Batman comics.
Yeah, if there was, like, a crossover or something.
Yeah, it was a crossover. So my OCD kicks in when I'm going through my Robin section. I'm like, well, I'm actually missing Robin 16 from the Robin box. So I've now gone through and decided I'm going to go pick up all those issues that I already have, but just so I can have a whole entire run. So that's kind of my new thing. And then finding, oh, there were a couple variants or a second printing or something like that. So maybe I can get by with not necessarily buying the same book again where, oh, this is the variant, so that's going to count. So comic book people, we have bad OCD or something.
Second printings, yeah.
Second printings, yeah.
And those are hard to track down, too, to see which books even have second or third printings.
And we talked about it during Troika. Like, all of us had thought that the
collector's editions,
the collector's
were, the
editions
only,
cover were the only ones. And to find out, Terrence pointed out, hey, there's actual, you know, newsstand editions. So those are some things that I want to try and pick up, the Batman Detective and Robin newsstand versions. Because those, until that podcast, I didn't even know those existed.
Yeah, and I listened to that and I noted it. I went back in my collection to double check, and I was like, I think I've got some of those, and I believe I've got all but one of those issues.
Oh, wow.
Collector's edition and newsstand both. I think I've even got it on my little thing right here. It's my running thing here. I think I need. Yeah, the only thing I need is Robin number 14. I need the newsstand version of that.
Gotcha.
But other than that, I've got all the other ones, which I was impressed too. I was like, wow, I can't believe that I end up actually have all the have all those.
Speaking of newsstand covers and everything like that, I wasn't necessarily going to talk about it on this show, but with it being Batman 50.
Thanks, Selina, for the daring last minute rescue. It was very heroic.
It was under control.
Sure it was. Now be a good damsel and bestow a kiss on your gallant hero.
Play nice.
You're not playing at all.
No, I'm not. Not anymore.
And what's that supposed to mean?
It means this is the end, Selena. It means we can. I can.
I will see you again, right?
No one will. Gotham needs something more, something worse, to defend her. She needs a new myth. A legend more powerful than I can be right now. A legend that can only rise from the ashes of the Batman.
Some things you can't do alone, Bruce.
And some things you have to.
Call if you need me.
I won't.
I know. I just wanted to say it.
And the hoopla going around it and all the variant covers. And Tim Drake is on a variant cover that I did purchase. I had to buy three of the covers to get it. But Batman 50, I kind of want to get to talk to you a little bit about it. You guys did a really good Batman on Film show. If you haven't listened to it, what was the episode number again? One?
Oh, I believe it's, let me look real fast. It's episode 120.
20. I would say
120. Yeah, and we since we get the issues a little early for advanced copies so we can review them for the website, we really wanted to be on top of things for that issue, so we actually recorded our review show for it on the Saturday before the issue dropped, which was great on our part because we wanted to talk about it, have a good discussion, and get it out so people, you know, could have a cool podcast to listen to about it as soon as they got their copies, even if they got copies at midnight or whatever. And then unfortunately all the, you know, the crap hit the fan with with DC spoiling the issue, and then all the spoilers coming out and stuff like that, and that kind of ruined the fun for a lot of people. So but the good thing is that, well, I guess unfortunately for people that got spoiled, but the good thing is if you listen to that BOF show, that is before all the drama and before all the hoopla happened. So it's, you know, it's unfiltered thoughts and unspoiled thoughts on that issue. So,
which I thought that was kind of cool, knowing that you guys had recorded it on a Saturday when everything broke on Sunday. I was like, man, you guys are really playing this straight as if you don't know. And I kept telling myself, no, actually at the time they're recording this,
we didn't know.
You didn't know. So
yeah, which in a way is good, otherwise we probably would have complained about it like half the time instead of talking about the actual book, which you know, has unfortunately happened. You know, I guess in some people's mind, you know, no, you know, any publicity is good publicity, but not my opinion. I mean, I'd rather be talking about the comic instead of the drama. So
yeah, definitely. I mean, that was something that, not to turn the whole thing into, you know, bad publicity, good publicity, but I still have a hard time going, like, in what way is that helping them at all to where, you know, seeing comic book retailers going, people are saying that they're canceling their issues because they already know, which I'm thinking, you're probably like, you're canceling your book already. Like, you're going to be like us. You're going to go pick the book up years later, just go get the darn thing. Or is it more the comic book shops are kind of just trying to give it to DC just for doing something like that?
Yeah, because again, our and Terrence went to this. I kind of missed it, but our local shop here, they had a Batman and Catwoman wedding spectacular event like planned for this whole thing, and they still had it, but I guess it kind of, the luster kind of wore off because the spoilers were out there. But they had like a legit wedding cake made that had like a Batman and Catwoman topper. They had a and they had an actual like a cosplay wedding. They had a Batman and a Catwoman cosplayer, and they had like all these cosplayers from like the Batman family like in the store. So they did like an in-store wedding and everything, and of course they had all the store exclusive variant issues you could get as well. So they tried to make it a really nice event. So, so it was kind of a fun thing to kind of, it's probably the biggest kind of event I've seen around a single issue of a comic book since Action 1000, which wasn't that long ago really, but it was fun. You know, I've been, in a nutshell, I've been really critical and hot and cold on my thoughts on Tom King's Batman run. Like, I know he's trying to do something different and all that, and sometimes it works for me and sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, sometimes it's just not for me. But in terms of the story, like, I thought it was good. I thought it was a cool issue. Like, the way it was written, the way it was done, the way it was presented with the splash pages and the letters that, you know, Batman and Catwoman wrote to each other and stuff like that, I thought that was really, really inventive and really well done. I'm kind of not eager to have to wait two more years for another 50 issues of this thing to see how it all pans out.
Right.
Like, is it telegraphed too far in advance? Like, are we really? I mean, what are we doing here? And you know, and I felt that way in Grant Morrison's Batman run too. Like, oh my gosh, how many more years of this are we gonna do?
Right.
But when it's all over, you're like, oh, that was great. I like that. Yeah. You know. So maybe we'll get to the same point with Tom King's Batman too. So I'm still willing to let it, you know, see where it goes.
Yeah. I mean, I miss the days of the one and done issues or a nice three story arc, which, I mean, he was kind of doing that anyway, and he'd have four or five issues here, four or five issues, but there's still a much longer narrative, even though he's telling the, you know, I am Bane or I am Suicide, there's still an overarching story that's going across.
Yeah. You know, I told Justin Kowalski the other day, I think I figured out what he should call his last three arcs. And if he doesn't do this, I'm going to be so pissed. But his last three arcs should be called, of course, they should be called I Am Vengeance, I Am Night, I Am the Batman, or I Am Batman. That's what his cool. last...
Yeah.
He has to do that now, or I'll be mad.
So, Tom King, I know you listen to the show. That's what Ryan...
Right.
Yeah, that's what we say you should probably do.
Too perfect not to.
My Batman 50 story is, with it being 4th of July, I didn't have the 4th of July off because I work for a warehouse that's like, hey, we got crap to move. So I had said something to my wife because she had the day off. She works in an office. And I was like, oh, it kind of sucks. I wish I could go get my Batman comic, Batman 50. The guy that I get comics from runs a gymnasium, and he was in Mexico, so I couldn't even get my books. I thought, well, there's this comic book shop, Alter Ego, that's not that far away. It'd be kind of cool to go there. And that's all that I said, like, oh, maybe I would go after work. So my wife decided, you know what, you're having to work today, and it was really hot. We don't really have a good AC unit in the house. So she's like, you know what, I'll go out for a drive. I'll go get some lunch. And she was going to go. She was watching their Facebook page, and they, too, did a wedding. So she's like, oh, I'll wait till it dies down so the crowd's not so big, and then she'll go later. So she drives about 45 miles to the comic shop to get to the front door and says, we decided to close early today. Happy 4th of July. And she's like,
oh,
are you kidding me?
Seriously.
And
why a comic book store in their right mind would close on a day where Batman 50 is out? Like, what do you stay open? It's new comic book day and it's Batman 50. Like, why would you close? That is so crazy to me.
And she was texting me on my 3 o'clock break and saying they're closed. I'm like, haha, funny. Who's closed? She's like, I decided to go to Alter Ego for you. And I'm like, oh, that's really sweet. She's like, no, I'm not joking. So I got on their Facebook page, and their post had literally said, 10 minutes ago, Alter Ego posted this. And I'm like, they literally just, like, they are inside the building still. So God bless my wife. She decided to drive the 45 miles back home and then drove an additional 45 miles in the opposite direction to another comic shop, and they were open. She called on the way this time, so I was able to
read. It's like, now don't close because it's 4th of July.
Yeah. And they said that they were going to be closing early. They would normally close at like 5 o'clock. They were going to close at 4. And she said, you know, I'm on my way. So they stayed open an extra, you know, 10, 15 minutes for her to come up. So I thought that was pretty cool. But so she drove almost 100 miles.
That's crazy.
For $4.99. And I'm like, oh.
That's crazy. That's not near. I do have a really crazy story about how I got my collector's edition copy of Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. But but maybe I'll save that for another day. Needless to say, it was a harrowing experience.
Some of those you just get so mad, and then you try and tell yourself, it's a comic book. It's $3. Why am I so upset about $3? And I was
No, it was the opposite of that for me. I was like, it's exclusive edition. It's never going to be released. There's only so many available. It's limited edition. I have to have it.
Well,
so.
And that's what I was after was the Jim Lee version of that.
Right.
And I don't know. It's just off my reach. I don't know whose variant it is, but it's Batman leaping out towards your POV, and his purple cape is showing. It's got an orange.
Oh yeah,
which is a cool cover. That wasn't one that I necessarily wanted, but when she got it, I thought, oh, that is actually a really, really decent cover. So yeah, I enjoyed 50 as well. Same with you. I've been hot and cold with some arcs. I'm like, I couldn't stand that. War jokes and riddles didn't work for me at all.
No,
but then the next arc wasn't too bad. So this was okay. So like you said, I want to do another 50? Like, okay, 2 years from now, we'll be right where we are. So,
yeah. Like, I've been catching up on my issues a lot over the past, month or so. Ever since we did our big Detective Comics show for BOF, I've been trying to catch up on my stacks of comics. Ever since Nora was born, my comic book reading has been non-existent, basically. So I've got a whole year's worth of issues I'm just like so behind on.
Yeah.
So I caught up with but now I'm like really trying to catch up and try to beat it. It's at that point where I could just like, just set them aside and be like, well, I've missed all that, but I'm trying to at least catch up on the stories I really care about and I'm trying to get current on. So I caught up with Detective, and then my next mission was to catch up on Batman and Tom King's Batman, and I caught up on that really quickly because a lot of those issues are fast reads anyway. Yeah. I think I've seen that in his run because it does ship twice a month. Some of the issues are splash pages or quick dialogue and stuff like that. So it was kind of fun to kind of read through, 25-ish issues. I kind of stopped where, I think at around issue 25 with the War of Jokes and Riddles, and then, but I caught up really fast because the issues are fast, and so I was thinking, I don't know if I want to, like, just wait until another arc or two is done and then blast through them or try to just stay current on it, But it was fun. So I mean, I caught up on that, and I caught up on Metal. I read all of Dark Knight's Metal, the miniseries as well, and the one shots and all that stuff. I read all that because all that led into No Justice, and all that led into the new Scott Snyder's Justice League. So I've caught up on all that, and right now my mission is to catch up on Superman. I've got Superman, Action Comics, and Super Sons, and I've got a bunch of that, and I'm a couple of issues away from finally getting to the Oz Effect. So that's around where I am on the Superman front at the moment, because I want to get through all that because we've got the new Bendis stuff that's coming, so I kind of wanted to get current on that because I want to give that Bendis stuff a shot too.
Yeah, okay. I'm caught up on Super Sons and Action and all that stuff. I'm just starting into Man of Steel. I'm liking it. I'm not liking it. I feel like I'm reading Tom King again. Maybe it's just because I've liked the
right.
Tomasi Gleason and Dan Jurgens run so well. That,
yeah.
Is it? Do I feel like okay? Yeah,
I'm sure it's a culture shift. Because for me, it's like this. Talking to Justin Kowalski, he's really big into this. Like this Superman triumvirate here, this Super Son, Superman and Action arc. This has been some of the best.
Oh, yeah.
Superman stuff I've read.
And I'm not a big Superman
in years. Guy. Like it is really good. No, me either. So my brief little Superman history here is like I got into to really heavily reading the Superman comics like pre New 52, like for like 2 or 3 years there before the New 52. There was a really good era of Superman comics there where you had Superman and Supergirl, yeah. And like Mon-El had been like in this main Superman title, and Superman had a new Kandor, I think, or something got created, like a new Krypton planet got created, so Superman had to like leave Earth to kind of oversee that and everything, and so they brought back this like the whole like Superman Shield numbering system, so like all the issues like fed into one another like in a giant like story arc, and it all led to this like War of the Superman thing, and so that kind of got me invested. That really got me invested in like the whole Superman lore in the world and stuff, because they did a really good job of bringing in all those things. I think, yeah, because like you had Superman and this new Krypton book, and you had Mon-El and Superman proper, and then you had like Nightwing and Flamebird, like the Krypton versions in Action Comics, and if you just say that, you know, to people, it's kind of a, it's not the traditional Superman structure, but they really sold the concept in the books themselves, and so I really enjoyed that stuff. But then as soon as it dovetailed into the New 52, they just lost me completely. Like very quickly they lost me, and so when this Rebirth stuff happened, it got me hooked right away, and then I've gotten so behind on the books, but even though they're really good, and so now I'm trying to catch up, and I've got nothing but good things to say about these issues. I mean, there's this two issue arc here in Superman that was like, and it's like I think it's called Declaration, where they just kind of go search, you know, they explore the United States landmarks,
two great issues,
you know, historical things. Yeah, and just it really hits a side of Superman that is hard to illustrate in a normal kind of traditional comic book setting, and to get, like, I don't want to spoil too much of it, but the way that ends was just so heartfelt and incredible and so Superman, and it's something that really got, you know, it's kind of an emotional ending there, and I just thought that kind of stuff is like what's going to make this run kind of last and be important, and hopefully people will appreciate that parts of these kind of parts of this run, especially now that it's over.
My brief Superman history was only just because of the death of Superman. You know, I was old enough to be around when that was going on, and I think the first Superman books I was buying when there was we covered it on this show, the two-part Night of the Bat storyline, where, you know, you've got your big new character in DC, and like, hey, we're going to bring Tim Drake Robin over into the Superman books for two issues. And then I always liked Superman as a character, but it wasn't something I read as a kid. If I had a Justice League book and Superman was in it, that was usually good enough for me, and I read through the Death and Return of Superman and all that stuff, but I wouldn't say quickly, because that was a decent-sized run, but I just ended up going, all right, I'm just going to go back to Gotham and stay where I was. So I'd pick up a Superman book every now and then, occasionally in the 2000s and 90s, but that was about it. So it wasn't until, you know, the New 52, I thought, okay, here's a good time to get back on Superman. I made it for two two issues, issue one, issue two, dropped it, and then Ramada and Johns came in, and I read through some of those, and then through the end up until Rebirth, I had stayed on the book. But when he went back to t-shirt and jeans Superman and had, you know, the cape wrapped around his fist because he had lost his powers after the solar flare, I was just like, oh my gosh, this is so not Superman. And then when Rebirth hit, I thought, well, I love Tomasi and Gleason on Batman and Robin. Their Superman has at least got to be as decent or good or maybe even better. And it was even better than Batman and Robin. And I loved their Batman and Robin. And then I thought, well, people are saying Jurgens is doing a really good job on Action. And he was, you know, one of the chief architects during the death and return of Superman. So I thought, well, I'm going to check that out. And that was great. So I think there was just this big buildup of Superman feeling like Superman again. And now Bendis is coming in and kind of wiping some slates clean, or maybe he'll put them back. So I'm toying with myself, and I even saw Justin Kowalski say this, like, all right, he'll give, you know, Action and Superman, you know, a chance a little bit before I, you know, before he jumps shark, or before I jump the shark or wherever, or bail rather. So I don't know how I feel about all that.
Yeah. Yeah. For me, like I'm not going to base the whole run off of like the miniseries thing, because I want to read the miniseries and then give each series like it's the first arc, right? And see how that goes, because I like the concept behind them all. Sounds intriguing to me, so I want to like it, you know. But there's also this new thing where I don't know if those books are still twice monthly or not. I think they are. But the prices have also increased. because DC like increased the price from $2.99 back to $3.99, and they took off the digital comic stuff, the copy stuff. So, you know, that's kind of making the bottom line a little bit harder to kind of justify keeping all the books on your table. So I do want to kind of use this as an opportunity to kind of, and that's kind of bad on DC's part sometimes too. Like, I think sometimes they'll do the new number ones to kind of attract new readers, but that's also tends to be the time where a lot of people that have stuck with the books just to stick with them will leave because as well. So I'm kind of I'll be on the fence for a little bit. That's why I'm trying to catch up, so I'll actually, you know, not get too far into just getting the books just to get them until before I, you know, realize that I don't like it, or if I
right.
do
and that there's I'll nothing keep, worse keep than being it, behind, so. And by the time you catch up, you to where you're like, oh, I would have dropped this if I'd have read through the first arc, and now I've collected three arcs and I'm not enjoying this first one. So I'm in the same boat of like, I've got two more issues of Man of Steel to read, but I'm already kind of like, all right, like you said, just the mini series, let's see where we go in the main titles and see how that goes from there. So at this point, we'd kind of like to take a little bit of your time, if we can, and kind of look back at the radio drama, look at some of your questions. Ryan wasn't here, unfortunately, because he was hanging out with Ernest, which is just as cool, but he didn't get a chance to talk to James, and kind of wanted to get your quick thoughts on the interview, if there was anything that you took away from it or anything interesting. You just kind of wanted to chime in, so I wouldn't give you a chance to kind of comment on that as well.
Yeah, I loved that interview. I thought that was a really good, high-energy kind of conversation with him, and it was glad to give him the spotlight, give him the floor to kind of, you know, get his thoughts on all these characters, you know, especially now that his run in Detective is over. It was good to get his overall thoughts on the whole thing. Which I really appreciated, and there was a lot of really good like masterclass level stuff of like, comic book writing, like what you think about when you're writing an issue, or how you plot things out, or how do you juggle, you know, writing your Detective Comics arc with the Batman who laughs at the same time kind of stuff. And, I mean, there was a lot of really good like deep discussion level questions about like character arcs and crafting issues and things like that. So I really enjoyed that conversation, appreciated it. I really hope that we're able to get him back on a future episode to talk more, because he's just really good, and I'm excited to follow his work as we go on. Like, I'm definitely going to pick up Justice League Dark to see what he's up to with that stuff, because he definitely he's really passionate about all these about the stuff that he does, and I'm excited to see where he goes with it, because you can see that passion in there. The only thing I was a little bit of a letdown is that nobody asked him about Azrael. Yeah, and didn't get him to expand on Azrael any. But that's my only knock on the episode.
He had a couple notes on it actually, and I forget, like, even as I was going back through listening to it while editing it, I'm going, oh, right there is where he had mentioned Azrael. I thought, oh, when we get to the follow-up question, and then he kind of had gone on a little bit farther, and listening to it, like, oh, that's where, now I drifted off. I'm like, oh, that's a really cool thing that he said. I totally forgot the Azrael line of it. And the thing that kind of impressed me, or the thing that changed that we all made mention of on when we did the BOF show, was the use of Clayface, where he said he initially intended him to be the comic relief of the book, and then he just turned into the heart of the book, and that was also going to be Tim Drake's position. It's like, oh, with Tim gone, it's going to be the real heart of the book, and Clayface kind of took over that role with Cassandra. And just to hear him talk about the creation of Clayface, and Peter had even said it too, that to me, that just became the definitive version of Clayface now. Like, the version of Clayface that I think and hear of is his version. Kind of took all those, which is what Rebirth does, takes all those best core elements of the character and goes, here's that version of the character that you know and love. And they just did a really good job on it. So that was really cool, just to get a chance to talk to him. And Clayface was just so cool.
Yeah.
So what I kind of want to do here, I put out on Twitter a little bit before the show or some questions, and we'll kind of go through some of your comments on the episodes here. We'll kind of, you know, round out the show that way real quick. Chadwick Whitley had replied to us. The image that I put up is from the Walmart issue, which we'll talk about in just a little bit as just a experiment from DC. But Tim Drake does appear in the issue. He's in his Rebirth Robin costume, but he's only got one R on. So some people are kind of like, oh, is this kind of like while he was Robin? Or I think it's just Dan Jurgens himself that he even said this is, in fact, Tim Drake in this Rebirth. It's, you know, the 100-page giant. There's 12 pages that are a new story that he's writing, and it's, in fact, Tim Drake. But he makes mention of that. But the cool thing is he gave us some questions out of the reply that I put, hey, we're doing the podcast today. If you got any questions, send them our way. So he's got five for us here, Ryan. So it says, I thought the radio drama was amazing. I would love to see more of it. Maybe a classic Tim Drake story like the first appearance miniseries or Lonely Place of Dying. Lonely Place of Dying, that'd be kind of cool to do something like that. But I feel like we kind of sort of did that in with a Lonely Place of Living. I know it wasn't the whole entire thing.
Plus, we have that with the Legends of Robin.
That radio drama was already... audio drama was so
audio
good
drama,
that... I mean, it'd be kind of cool to do it, but if I was going to do another one, and there'll probably be another one at some point, I don't know if that'd be the first thing that I would that I'd hop on. He says, I really appreciate the James Tynion interview. Coming in for the interview, I found him engaging. You guys asked a lot of great questions. How about other creators like Marcus Tove, Fabian DeSiza? I always say his last name wrong. Adam Beechin, would love to hear their retrospective. So those were some names I hadn't even thought about. We're trying to get Tom Grummet. I've emailed him a couple times back and forth, but he's doing the con circuit right now. So if you're listening to this, we're trying to get Tom on the show, but it's been kind of a little bit harder than I had anticipated for. I'd asked a question, what was your favorite Robin costume? And he says his costume is the 1 year later red and black suit with the OG Robin costume at a very close second. I've said that before on the show. I love the classic Robin costume, but there was just something cool about the red and black. And I think just because the animated series was going on at the same time and Tim had a new look there. I mean, I'm really torn. I think the 1 year later gets a close first place for me, but do you have a favorite Robin costume? And not even Tim Drake, just Robin in general.
No, yeah, I'm kind of right there. The 1 year later costume I think is really good, and it is a mid grade second place to me. I still think that the actual Tim Drake standard Tim Drake costume, you know, is my favorite.
Yeah,
because I think it's the most versatile. I think it holds up. It's still, it's kind of a lot of people have said that this is one of the better or one of the best like costume redesigns of a character that there is, and I'd have to agree to that. It's Neil Adams, you know, and I just think it just works. It updated the outfit. It looks a little bit more tactical. They closed off the legs. It's not bare legs anymore. And that black to yellow, I think really really works. And you know, you even see that like, and that stayed on through the 1 year later outfit, and that's, you know, that's in the current outfits too, even Damien's outfits like that as well. So, it just kind of works for me. And you've got the split toe, you know, boots and the staff, and that all works for me. And like you said, that Robin, I think, like consumer products and things at the time were just itching for that Robin redesign, because once that came out, like you saw it everywhere, because it was in the animated series, probably because of that animated series. And then you saw it in, like, I'll never forget the Batman Returns Tim Drake right Robin now action figure, because they even like put their stamp on it by they actually included the split black and yellow cape, which I still remembered. I loved it as a kid. I just thought that was the coolest thing. And of course that trickled into Batman Forever too, I don't think that costume would have looked as close as it did unless we had the Tim Drake costume to kind of be its predecessor. So and they also did the black and yellow thing there too. So, but yeah, so Tim Drake, original Tim Drake number one.
I think that's
1 year later.
It depends on the day. I think I like the character enough that I'm like, if I'm reading, that's probably my problem is if I'm reading the new red and black costume at the time, I'm like, oh, this is my favorite. And then I start reading the Chuck Dixon run. I'm like, oh, this is my favorite. I mean, both costumes, I think, work very well. But to me, the biggest thing about the costume, like closing off the legs was huge. But giving Tim a black cape that he could wrap around himself, where like Robin can't hide in the shadows. Well, guess what? Now he can. He's got the black lining, and that was really cool.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just, like you said, it translated very well that even going into the new 52, they're like, okay, Dick Grayson's not going to wear the short shorts anymore. So it's a version of Tim Drake's character. Like this needs to be the pseudo Robin costume for all Robins moving forward. It translates so well. And yeah, sometimes people are like, oh, that's Dick Grayson's costume, where we're like, no, it's Tim's. But now it's a Robin costume. It's become as iconic as the pixie boots and short shorts were. Something else that he had asked here, questions for us. He was kind of replying to us. Who is your definitive Tim Drake artist, writer, and where do you hope DC will take Tim next? Who would you like to write or see draw Tim Drake going forward? Why don't you take this one at first?
Tom Grummett artist and Chuck Dixon writer. Yeah. I think that's the thing there. I mean, he was so influential in the, the early part of him with the miniseries and stuff, as well as the 100-ish issues he did of the main series. I think that's good because it just provides his Tim Drake's foundation. And I think he picked up, on that, and he took all the things that he learned, all these lessons from what came before about the other Robins and the other writers, and then helped craft Tim Drake into one of the most memorable Robins there is. So I think there's that. And now that we've had this giant Tynion run, it's hard to tell where they're going to take Tim Drake after this. I don't want them to do anything weird with him, like make him Batman Beyond again or anything weird, stuff like that. I'd like Tomasi and Gleason to tackle Tim Drake, because I think, they've done such a great job with the Superman stuff, and they did a good job with the Batman and Robin series with Damian and stuff. I think I'd like to see their take on Tim Drake too, but overall, I just like to see Tim have his own book.
I would
again,
too. I mean, really? That was something that James said in the interview, that he's excited to be just a fan of Tim again, and knows that there's, plans for Tim. Heroes in Crisis? There's an ad right now that I'm scrambling trying to find it. Poor podcaster. But if you're getting the DC Nation issues, either free at your comic book shop or whatever, there's an ad in there for the Heroes in Crisis that Tom King is going to be writing. And in there it says, one of these heroes is a murderer, one of them gets killed, one of them is blamed, and one of them is on the run. And guess who is one of those heroes? Tim Drake, Red Robin. Along with, Nightwing and, I think it looks like 25 other heroes that are going to play a part in the story. So I'm hoping that Tim's not one of any one of those. He's just in the story somewhere. I'm like, we just got Tim back. Don't screw with him. Give him his own series. If he gets his own series out of this Heroes in Crisis thing, that's cool. But I think the character at least needs to be on some version of the Titans at the least. But I would like to see him in his own type of series, or him in Spoiler or something like that. So we got some from Twitter here. Green Lantern HQ says, the future seems pretty grim a lot for DC characters, but I always hope they won't go down that road. What are your thoughts and feelings of Tim Drake's future? I know we've already talked about it, but it seems like Tim would actually give up who he is and become something else. I don't see him killing someone. Would that be an answer or a problem? I hope that's not true. I don't know. So that's just kind of a statement that he made. I don't think they're going to would do something like that again. I think, like we had talked about in the Tynion discussion, that James brought all these characters back to a new starting point again, where somebody else can pick up and write new adventures with him. It's not like, all right, well, James left Tim on this murderous spree. He's very hopeful and he wants to travel down the road and see where the adventure takes him. So I think that kind of leaves his slate kind of open and clean again. And I'm enjoying kind of reading him right now in the Walmart 100 issue special they got going on. So that's tiding me over till something else. I don't know if you have any comment on that at all, Ryan.
Yeah, I hope not. I hope that they're kind of done with the whole weird angles on Tim, you know, like I said, like the Batman Beyond thing. I just want heroic Tim right. doing Tim Drake stuff. And I just want to see something like that.
Of a DC streaming service where you were talking about the split boots and just your since we were on the costume talk, I don't know if I've heard you say on a podcast yet, but the Teen Titans, we've kind of seen some of Brandon Thwaite's Robin costume, kind of like a shot type will, where he's kind of profile. The news from the streaming came out. We got two more images of him, and man, that sure looks like Tim Drake, where the costume looks cool. And
it does. Again, it's like your whole example of like, yeah, just steal everything from Tim Drake and give it to all the other Robins. Thanks. Yeah. But yeah, I'm excited for Titans, especially the more we learned about it, how they're going to try to show, the backstories of these characters and stuff like that. And I think they're going to try to delve into it in a serious way. I guess it's going to be kind of a interesting thing to see how they approach it. But yeah, it'll be the most accurate live action Robin that we have, the only comparable thing is Chris O'Donnell's Robin, which is kind of crazy to think about, but yeah, seeing the cost and just looking at the costume, I don't really have any issues with that costume. I think it looks great. In my opinion, I think it looks better even than the way he looks like in the Arkham games. You know, I'm not really a huge fan of that Tim Drake, to be honest. He's just kind of too generic, I'm gonna say. There's not much to him, I don't think. But yeah, I like the way that Dick Grayson's Robin looks in Titans, and like I even saw that. I noticed they had the split toe boots too.
And then we've got Young Justice coming up, which I think that's going to be the first part of 2019. I don't think that'll be released this year, but you know, Tim Drake's.
Oh yeah, I need to actually catch on up on that too. I haven't even gotten to that. Tim Drake shows up in that show, doesn't he? Jeez. Yeah, I'm halfway through season one, so I'm trying to catch up.
Like a Saturday, just do a binge watch of season one and season two, and to know what 4 years have passed, almost five. By the time that season three starts, 5 years will have passed from season two. That, you know, here's a show we never thought was ever going to see the light of day. And say what you will about, you know, release the Snyder Cut, the Young Justice fans, I think, was just about as adamant as, you know, do season three, when there was no network, and where places were saying like, well, toys aren't selling, that's why we can't get back on the Cartoon Network, where it's sad to think a toy is what's preventing you from doing a show.
It is, and it was, but now that we have streaming stuff, like Netflix has opened this thing up of like, if people just watch this. Imagine that. If people watch a show, they'll make more of a show. So hopefully this DC thing will open up DC to be able to do more stuff like this, and I think it's pretty exciting.
Yeah,
so
and
I'm
just
glad
all the
they're taking a shot with
they're
it.
They're going to have that from old animated series, and, you know, I saw your tweet the other day. I forget what quote-unquote news network, air quotes, was saying, hey, the animated series is going to be HD on the streaming service. And you were like, that was news I already stated. But, that, I mean, that's cool that it's the...
yeah, it was part of the announcement
like
when they announced it a few weeks ago.
We
already
know that. But that's cool to know that that's going to be there. I hope that doesn't take place of like, oh, we were going to do this Blu-ray, but now we're just going to have it on. Yeah.
No, they're still doing the Blu-ray. Yeah, I even... I wrote into the I wrote a physical letter to the Warner Archive podcast asking about the Blu-ray stuff.
Oh, wow, that's
cool. And they actually responded to my letter about it, like the one or two episodes ago. You can go find that podcast, and they'll talk about how good my handwriting is and stuff like that. So, but I think their answer was, I'm trying to decode what their answer was, but I believe they were saying that, these last releases they had for Mask of the Phantasm and Sub-Zero were through the Warner Archive, and those opened the door of like making Warner proper be like, oh, people will buy this. So I think that the Blu-ray is actually going to probably end up being done by, Warner Brothers proper, cool. Not the Warner Archive, because I believe they're going to try to make it a bigger deal, like an actual like box set or something with actual features and things like that. Don't quote me on that, but that's what I think that they were inferring on that Warner Archive podcast episode. So we'll find out here in a couple of weeks at Comic Con. There's going to be a panel, so hopefully they'll do right by the fans, because it'll be exciting.
I'm excited for Comic Con anyway, because I feel like there's going to be some announcements of things or even products that we don't even know are on the horizon. That this is also where they're probably going to make announcements for the animated films coming up after the death and return of Superman that's coming out.
Yes, they are definitely doing that. We're going to find out all the 2019 movies.
I would love to hear Nightfall mention something.
I know. I told the PR guy, Gary, I was like, please say Nightfall, fingers crossed, please say Nightfall. If you finish Death of Superman, yeah, you gotta do Nightfall.
The last thing I have here before I go into the comment sections for the radio drama is the Walmart 100-page DC giant event, which, we've kind of already talked about a little bit on the show. We were going to do a review of it, but unfortunately Ryan wasn't able to get a hold of it, and that's good thing, but I think it's kind of a jerky thing at the same time that people are having a hard time getting it. We were just going through Walmart on vacation a week ago, 2 days, just went to a bigger city just to kind of chill out and use a hotel's AC and pool that we were we went through a Walmart just to go get some stacks for the hotel, and I saw them there. My wife's like, can't we just get these at home? And I said, well, I don't know, I maybe not be able to find them. So I bought two of them, and I get home to my hometown Walmart, can't find them anywhere. So people are buying these in gigantic chunks, which if there are like 10 copies on the shelf and 10 people bought one each for themselves, okay, that's cool. But it sounds like one person is just buying all of them and throwing up on eBay.
Buying
and they're
all
also taking the cardboard box that the books – the stands that they go in.
The stands.
It's what? Jeez. Bi-monthly? Yeah. So in a month from now, when those books come out and the Walmart worker goes to put them on the shelf, guess what? There won't be a box for them to put them in. So.
Yeah. Because I'm sure people are like, oh, they're all sold out. And they're probably either taking the stands or asking like, hey, these are sold out. And of course, they don't know, they're asking the wrong person. They're probably just saying, yeah, take whatever. And it's kind of crap. It's like defeating the purpose of the whole thing, because me and Terrence live in the same area. I've been to like 4 Walmarts in this area, and none of them have the 100-page giants. And so I'm just like, I'm out. I'm not doing this. I was already like on the fence because of the whole why are they doing this? I understand why they're doing it, because they want to open it up to a wider audience, because people that shop at Walmart might not necessarily be people that shop in comic book stores, and getting people invested in the characters and the worlds, might attract them to actual comic stores, because the 100-page giants are set up to be like, well, here's part one of Hush. Oh, if you want to read more of Hush, maybe you should go to the comic book store and buy the trade. I think that's kind of the... But the draw is, I guess, is they're also putting these exclusive stories, one exclusive story per book. So you've got the Brian Michael Bendis writing a Batman story, and Tom King writing a Superman story, I think. And of course, there's a Tim Drake Teen Titans story by Dan Jurgens. And so that's the hook for the people that are already buying comics in the shops. But it's kind of a bad deal overall when, like, scalpers or whatever just buying all the issues, and so people looking for them like us can't find them, and people looking for them that just might see them on a shelf also aren't going to see them because they're just being kind of snatched up. So I'm kind of wondering if how good this initiative is going to pan out.
I have a problem with it, that the idea behind it, I think, is sound. Yeah, good DC trying to put products out there, but you're putting it down the ball card, the magic aisle, the novelty section, where nobody's going down other than the kids and young adults, or even, you know, us, which I guess that's your target base too. But that is their target. At the same time, yeah. Why aren't they in the newsstand with all the other magazines, where maybe somebody that doesn't even know that's where that stuff is located may pick it up and go, oh, I haven't read a Batman comic in years. This is pretty cool. Where can I find the rest of it? So if you don't know to go to that spot, I would think the periodical section might be the better place for things like this, where you're going to get people just going down to, hey, I'm going to get the new issue of ESPN. Oh, what's this Batman comic thing? So that may be where I would have put it, in the book aisle, as opposed to that. But like you said, if that is their target audience, then I guess it's probably in the right spot. But 45-year-old guys like myself are going through buying all of them so nobody can find them, then you just...
I think Terrence was sending us some copies of people selling these things on eBay. They're $5 a piece, and somebody was selling one each of the four issues for $75. So it's like, man,
yeah,
this is annoying. Dang it.
So, yeah. This is going to be kind of our quick little show here. The last thing I have on our notes is what's up next for the Drake. We're going to go back to the comics, and something that we've talked, I think the three of us talked about this in May, like, hey, what's the next thing that we're going to do? So you can do your detective work at home, is the King Snake story that ties in between Detective Comics 685, 686, and Robin 17 crossover, which is kind of cool that it's tying back into the Chuck Dixon verse, even though that... You know, there'll be other stories. Robin will kind of bounce. He won't bounce so much into the Batman title as he will into Chuck's other books. Like, Robin will start, he'll dip into Catwoman, and he'll go into Nightwing, and he'll go back to Detective and the bigger story in Batman or whatever. So I'm kind of cool, or kind of glad to go back to the 90s again and start getting into some of the getting past, like I've been saying for a long time, getting past Nightfall, getting past Troika. Now we're just getting into Robin story. So this is going to be a really cool time on the podcast, and we'll have, you know, other little variants and deviations kind of go along the way. But I'm kind of excited where the podcast is going to go comic wise. And there's some books in this run that I'm like, I've never read issue 25. So covering it on the podcast will be the first time I'm reading some issues. So that's going to be kind of cool. What are your kind of thoughts just going forward for the podcast?
Yeah, I'm really excited to get to this like bulk of unexplored territory and stuff, and to jump back in after you know our grab bag episode here, summer break here, and in the audio drama. I think it's going to be great to jump back into a 3-issue arc that covers Detective and Robin. That brings back King Snake. Is this the third time we've seen King Snake, or the second? It might even be the final time, from what I remember. So yeah, that's going to be cool to see how that pans out, to see King Snake back, because he ends up being one of Robin's more prolific villains here. So yeah, that's exciting.
Yeah, we're going to get a new artist on the book, so I'm excited to see, you know, how we've kind of leaving you know, Nightfall kind of behind in the dust now, and kind of moving forward. So, okay, for a show about nothing, we managed to cram an hour's worth of stuff there. And because my dumb idiot hands kept unplugging my mic, we had to start and restart 3 different times. So I think the audio kind of got out of sync towards the tail end. but I believe it's listenable. You probably won't notice that much. It kind of sounds like I'm talking over Ryan just a tad, but it's usually the other way around. So at the end of that, we were going to go into your listener feedback section, and I have recorded that on my own, and that is 46 minutes in and of itself. So I think I just banked another episode, and I answer some other email questions and things that have come in. So I think that's going to be another show, and that's already in the can. So that may get fit into a show at another time, or maybe we'll get a second episode out of this month. So this is where we're going to end this episode right here. I want to thank everybody for writing in, and I've been saying it for a couple. We will get to that, but I think it'll be nice just to have a listener email feedback section. And we did cover a couple of those with Ryan on there, but I do go through more of the Twitter and Facebook comments. But that's where we're going to end this one right now. So you can get a hold of Ryan and Terrence on social media. You can find both of them on Twitter. Terrence is at O'Neill Ties on Twitter, and Ryan is at SMB underscore Ryan. He also has his Asriel podcast that's not up yet. I believe he's getting it ready soon. Denny O'Neill interview. Denny O'Neill interview, get that up. But you can find his Asriel podcast on Twitter at Asriel Podcast. And you can find Terrence and I's sister show at Batman and Robin Eternal. And that Twitter is really kind of crazy. We really should have rethought this. I like the title of Batman and Robin Eternal, but trying to get a Twitter handle was a little tricky. But it is at Band R Eternal Pod. That's Batman and Robin Eternal. So BANDRETERNALPOD, Batman and Robin Eternal Pod. Band R Eternal Pod. That's a really long Twitter, but I think you guys can get it. We have 7 episodes now available. The 7th one just went up with Sherlock Ward. She guested on the show, and we broke it up into 2 parts. The first part's up where we just talk about Jason Todd, so that's kind of a cool new podcast that I think we're going to do about 12 episodes, one a month, just to give us a little extra Batman and Robin talking where, you know, some of these things don't fit into this podcast. You can follow me on Twitter at DrummerRob10 and, of course, at ELTD Podcast. So on behalf of Ryan and Terrence, this is Rob, and you've been listening to the BatmanUniverse.net. And more importantly, you've been listening to Robin. Everyone loves the Drake. We'll see you in a couple weeks. Take care.
Drums, bye. Please.
Thanks for listening to Robin, Everyone Loves the Drake podcast. This has been brought to you by the BatmanUniverse.net. Tim Drake, Robin, and all Batman-related characters are under copyright of DC Comics. This podcast is solely for entertainment purposes, so no infringement is intended by this show. This show is not a good revenue stream. Actually, there's not a stream at all. All music and sound clips are under copyright by their respected copyright holders. So there should be no need to send the Penguin's lawyers after us for ill-gotten gains, because there are none. You can get a hold of the show a few different ways. We are on Twitter at ELTD Podcast. You can also email in at robineltdpodcast@yahoo.com. Our Facebook page can be found at www.facebook.com/everyonelovesthedrake. And as always, you can message directly over at the batmanuniverse.net. So email, tweet, or message us. We'd love to hear from you, and we'll read your comments or responses on the show. The show you're listening to can be found a few different ways through iTunes and Windows Media, also over at our host, TVU. Leave us a review on iTunes if you listen there. It'll help spread the word of the show. Make sure you head over to the BatmanUniverse.net, your home for all things Batman and Robin. Thanks for listening to the show and hearing why everyone loves the Drake. We'll see you in a few weeks. Take care. The weather is hot and girls are dressing less and checking out the fellas to tell them who's best. Riding around in your Jeep or your Benzos, or in your Nissan sitting on Lorenzo's. Back in Philly, we be out in the park. A place called the Plateau is where everybody go. Guys out hunting and girls doing likewise. Honking at the honey in front of you with the light eyes. She turn around to see what you beeping at. It's like the summer's a natural aphrodisiac. And with a pen and pad, I compose this rhyme to hit you and to get you equipped for the summertime.
I ain't been on the court yet. Hustle to the mall to get me a short set. Yeah, I got on sneaks, but I need a new pair. Cause basketball courts in the summer got girls there. The temperature's about 88. Hop in the water plug, just for old time's sake. Break to your crib, change your clothes once more. Cause you're invited to a barbecue to start at 4. Sitting with your friends, as y'all reminisce about the days growing up and the first person you kiss. And as I think back, makes me wonder how the smell from a grill can spark off nostalgia. All the kids playing out front, little boys messing around with the girls playing double dutch. While the DJ spinning a tune as the old folks dance at your family reunion. Then 6 o'clock rolls around. You just finished wiping your car down. It's time to cruise, so you go to the summertime. Hang out, it looks like a car show. Everybody come looking real fine. Fresh from the barbershop, a fly from the beauty salon. Every moment frontin' and maxin'. Chillin' in the car, they spend all day waxin'. Leanin' to the side, but you can't speed through. 2 miles an hour, so everybody sees you. There's an air of love and of happiness. And this is the Fresh Prince's new definition of summer madness.